wanted to talk about a project that I did this summer over the. A project I did this summer over at Capital Technology University involving CubeSats, both the onboard software and a control center that we implemented for them. It might have sounded like what I did on my summer vacation, but that's what I did on my summer vacation. So, I'm for John Hopkins here and also for Capital. Capital is a small college on the other side of the world. That has three edges. One is they're a mile from my house. Second is they have a pull-up satellite control center. And the third is they have an aerospace engineering program going on. So what we did was in a group of some 20 exchange students from Brazil under a program that they run called Scientific Mobility. They do this with a bunch of different countries, the U.S., England, France, Spain, and they very carefully select their people. So when you get people through this program, they are very good. They're very good. And they all have a not just a work college of English, they my two co-authors could be here today. Guilherme is in Porto Alegre, Brazil, South Brazil, and Gabriel is at University of Colorado. Guilherme was at University of Colorado, Denver, before he came for the summer program, and he had to go back to Brazil, and Gabriel was finishing up at University of Colorado, Colorado Springs, and then he goes back to South Paulo. Later on, one of the more interesting aspects of this whole thing is run up like a global cooperative program. I'm still working with them. They're still cranking because we need to be in the same place. For Shal, when Gabriel went back before class started, he got a cheap ticket to Hawaii because he'd never been there. So, not that bitter about that, but we were working on it with me here and him in Hawaii. So the summer program was two classes, CubeSat Engineering and CubeSat Operations. In an 8-week session, the students came in, they lived in the dorms, they took these two classes and they built a CubeSat and learned to operate it. There were 20 senior undergrads, 19 program, one for the Capital student to begin with. And the idea here, and I'm doing my best, I'm trying to teach next generation play software people. It's a good step. Normally I teach embedded systems, and my embedded systems class had heavy aerospace plant because of my background. So specifically teaching a play software or a play hardware course is that's where I'm coming. So we teach them good system engineering process. We give them the NASA system engineering handbook and memorize it and apply this. We do the challenges in the space environment, and then we'll build, test, and operate a prototype to set. One of the co-professors over there is actually building his own CubeSat, and he's written several books on the topic. So he's eminently qualified to tell people how to do it. I wasn't quite sure of the protocol, so I brought my own satellite flight computer. I don't know if anybody else brought their flight computer, but I did. I wanted to mention, it's not currently possible to get CubeSat from Walmart. It's just the bag I grabbed on the way to the door. I have to believe within 5 years you can probably do that. But anyway, this just show you that's how big a CubeSat is, a 1-unit CubeSat. We print these on a 3D printer. This is not the most up-to-date model. We have shelves in it for the electronics and all. This is used to check that everything fits, and we're not trying to put too much stuff in there. And then during the summer weren't for flight, they were prototype. So we just basically used plastic box. This is the latest Raspberry Pi model essentially used for the flight computer. Interesting things, but that I'll get to here. CubeSat has the volume of a liter, mass not to exceed little more than a kilogram, commercial off the shelf components, compatible with any launch vehicle. This release is kind of a we can stack these up, but when it gets ordered, it kind of kicks them out. Found, which I thought was amazing, was CubeSats typically replace SAM in the launch vehicle. They use SAM to balance the launch vehicle, so the center of mass is, the center of thrust is the center of mass. So instead of launching SAM, we launch process SAM. They go with any launch vehicle. I'm not sure about the North Koreans, but anything else, the French, Russians, our stuff, you can send up the CubeSat, multiple CubeSats. Three flyers, which is typical, they can be attached to the space station. There's a space station, so you can pick them out of the outside for a while and bring them back, which would actually be the preferred for our mission that I'll talk about in a few minutes. Limited life, by definition, they're not supposed to be up more than 6 months. It's supposed to re-enter. So we don't worry too much about longevity issues because they're going to die in 2 months. Extremely limited downlink. This is so 1960s. We have communication over wire. Only over land. Some stats actually use a cell phone, and that works in roughly 1 bit per second communication rate. So there's some very dear limitations on the downlink. We'll get a lot more out of wireless than the 1 bit per second, but we're not going to get negative. There's a consortium of universities. United States, each one agrees to do a communication and the data traffic moves on the internet. So CAPTA will be joining that consortium. We'll put up a dish and we'll send a little data to them when their satellites are in new ops and they'll do the same favor. CubeSat by individuals like my friend Sandy. High schools, colleges, and also a professional project. That was the thing I found that when I wasn't looking, the CubeSat technology, amazingly good. I mean, the kind of stuff we're doing at the college level is employed, but it's not much of a mission. But NASA itself and a lot of other agencies and the Air Force are using CubeSats to verify individual instruments and stuff like that to up the TRL level. Because you can check out an instrument for $100 instead of for $2 million. Some of the longer life CubeSats using TruePlay hardware. So there's this whole cottage industry. You can go buy a radiation hardened CubeSat computer, you can buy all the individual pieces if you have money, or you can print them yourself. Different usage scenarios, but it works. The huge commercial infrastructure in CubeSat. So our computer here, we won't use the plastic case. This is a pretty amazing computer. 32 bits, quad core, brilliant, 900 hertz, ARM architecture, gigabyte of static RAM, and a micro SD card. We used 8 gigs. We didn't need any more. They'll take 16 and probably larger than that. My background is flight computers are just incredible numbers. They have 4 USBs in this model, the Ethernet, and general purpose IOs, which we use for sensors and in some cases operating bolts, specs, is a $30 part. And interestingly enough, and references at the end of the presentation, one summer student did the radiation tolerance testing on a Raspberry Pi and a similar architecture there, Arduino, up at the part of the Spending Brook, which is where Goddard's involved stuff radiation testing. So I ran a series that they run on all hardware. The Raspberry Pi, the straight $30 part from Amazon.com, what that, it would keep accepting login requests up to 150 kbps, which is a high number. Now, the Arduino was about half that, but we're back to seeing how we actually use a dual Raspberry Pi and Arduino pair. And we have tricks to find out if we're getting radiation damage and how to, you know, go reset stuff and that stuff. So it's a 6-month mission. What's the worst thing to that? The software, Blade software, is the standard Linux, which comes with the Pi. It's not a real-time system. We don't have a particular real-time requirement, but we modify the Linux to be close with the real-time patch and the non-preemption patch. We also build a version of true real-time Linux, but at the moment we have no requirement to do that. You have to, on the Pi, add a real-time clock. So you know how it is with budgets. It's $9 for a real-time clock on that. It does host the core plate system, Alan's little project, and make use of that as a city. And we run our application code in C and Python. This is covered, and I won't go into this. The core plate system for Goddard is very useful for what we're doing, just plug and play on this particular So we used FreeTools. We used the telemetry system that I sent message manually and sensor stuff. Actually, one of these we wrote. I forget which one. We needed a piece of glue code, but we used three of the CFS modules as is on the architecture. What we have, I need to talk about the controller software, but also to explain that we have two different rooms, one is the lab and the other is the control center, and we were simply using Wi-Fi. We can get with that rigorous testing. We could use wired net or wired Ethernet, which is what we would do on a real mission. To let it come down on the 433 megahertz channel, somebody would put it on the internet for us and we pick it up. And but we just use Wi-Fi, and there were advantages for that, actually. So, in our control center. So, a true control center, capital is 5 miles from Goddard. It's a hard, dedicated hardware link. And the control center is used, it's got maybe a dozen seats, and it's used to train operators of spacecraft. And then they get jobs at Goddard as interns operating spacecraft. So it's a very interesting program to a lot of different people that, you know, want to do that. So it's a classical control center. It's what you've seen in Apollo 13, except not that big. PC architecture. We have one big screen at the front of the room, and, but half machines are running Linux and half runs Windows 7. So when we start the project, I knew what I wanted to do, but I didn't want to do it. But heck, I had 8 weeks, so it wasn't like there was schedule pressure. So Alan Cudmore came over one day, he saw what we were doing, and he said, "Hey, you should look at this software product called Cosmos from Boulder State, but in Colorado, it's a control center software. Hey, I'll look at that. So we got Cosmos up and running. Like I said, every Cosmos project will be open source. One will not be violated. The whole thing will be open. So Cosmos, which is open source, and it runs this stuff. And I know because normally you mix open source and closed source, the open source gets contaminated. Although there's a lot of programs you can that are open source you can run under Windows and anyway, I'll give you. Went back to Ball and said open source software does it run Linux? And they said it should. Okay. Linux port. And they said no. So, hey, Gary. I implemented it for me. Gary Michael Goddard came over. He's not with the Flight Software branch. He said, oh, heck, I'll do that for you. So he did it over the weekend. And he did it the right way. Took the code from the GitHub. He put for Linux, and he put back on GitHub, and we told Paul about it. So here's your Linux version. Looking, you know, hey, we had fun. So now we had a true open source version of this control center software. In this section, on the Linux host, which is over on the left-hand side, we have Cosmos trying some of its applications. Raspberry Pi on the other side with some physical sensors on it. Cosmos is sending command packets to Pi. It's sending back telemetry, all that gets displayed. We all added into Linux host the Apache server. I wanted to do something interesting with that. I looked at my telemetry data from the web-enabled device. So I want to see it on my phone. I want to see it on my laptop. I want to be there for looking at it. Control Center, to go back for a second, it was actually established back in 2002. We've had it for a while. There's quite a few student operators. It was done for NASA grant. They said it got to be a high-speed line. It's an open facility. So the ground system software I was talking to my project CubeSat is Cosmos. It's open source. I asked them. They said it's ITAR compliant. So that was good. Having gotten wrapped up in some ITAR issues at one point. So I, built by Gary here, was the Linux version, Mountain Linux 14.04. We got all the hacks, we glued it together, we verified everything worked, knew the SID part, and then put the Apache web server in. I said something about the students. I didn't have any great say in selecting the students, so we had 18 slots open. We had 14 engineers, and five electrical computer science people. Of which I three of those assigned to a team that was on an old NASA robot project that they dropped off, and the other two guys worked with me on this control center software. We were pretty good, just didn't have the software background I was looking for. But the two guys I got were just incredibly good. I mean, they didn't, had never been in touch with an aerospace project before they showed up. This whole thing was done. I needed to tell them what needed to be done, and then I needed to get it out of the way. And they did it. So, they stayed, it was an 8-week program, they stayed during the month of August because of anything better to do. We're getting paid, they got to stay in the dorms for free, and then continue to work on this project. And as they're continuing to work on it where they are now. And I'll email them, but I can tell the presentation went well. Okay, just a couple of interesting things. We were running on one of the machines in the control center and decided to put it on my laptop, one of my laptops. So I had an old Lenovo with a Celeron in it and put the whole control center on that. That and talked to the CubeSat and did manage. It had telemetry over there, so I could go somewhere else and look at my telemetry data coming in. So basically, we went in the control center, got it running on my laptop, the lights and left. And that's the rest of the development work that's done from their dorm room, which is a neat list. Gabriel was an expert in Android development. He set up one of my laptops with the Android development suite on it. Because I still learned how to do Android apps. I have an Android world on my phone as far as I got. He was incredibly good at Android apps. So I said, okay, what I want you to do here is we're taking telemetry data, we're putting it into a database, which is really nice, a true honest-to-God SQL database. But I'll show you that in how this works is for each telemetry point you define, you get the set red and yellow limits, as you would expect. And they come up on the screen and, you know, it tells you alert, voltage, whatever. I said, I want you to send me a text message. I don't really have to go in and monitor my telemetry anymore. I mean, that's the 1970s. I just get a text message or something. Caused a bunch of selected apps. These are some of the ones that had telemetry viewer, telemetry grapher, telemetry extractor, that type of thing. Everything you need in the control center piece of software. Web server we put in was the standard Apache open source web server. And make the telemetry extractor module to Apache. Just basically send it over the data flow page. Along the way, telemetry extractor comes up with text, and we just converted it to HTML on the fly. And it just got displayed. A lot of engineers to this approach. We were doing automation, low-cost software, low-cost hardware. The open source gave us a lot of flexibility in different products that we can pick up. Heavyweight products like a web server, you know, just trying to work. We in this time where you don't go to the control center anymore. You have it with you. You want to look up something, get your phone, check that telemetry point, and the software has your back. It's going to tell you if something went wrong. Because I'm a true web server, we can set up your telemetry pages. The person would have a thermal page, electrical power person, sensor, electrical power page, whatever. You can do your own page, whoever you're interested in. One guy at the head of all this, the team lead, the system engineer, whatever you call him, would have visibility over all the data and would also control command. If you do your own one, it would be a lot to issue command. So system engineers, thermal, ACS, alerts from their domain, as text, or we could send an email in there. We also are working on extending the role of the limit checker within Cosmos. We want to make a smart limit checker. We don't want it to just say, you know, exceeded the red limit. We want to do trending. We want to do some cross-discipline correlation. We don't know that, gee, the temperature is up on on this side of the spacecraft, we want to know itself, because we're pointed the wrong way. You know, you had corner pointings with the sun, it shouldn't be that way. So as we go along, as we've learned, we're going to make the limit checking module in there a lot smarter. Operating right now with a collaborative project, and this whole thing, if we get it right, is going to evolve into, well, control centers and servers. As I mentioned, use uplink and downlink as a service now, the data moves on the internet. I want my laptop back, so I can take that whole control center thing and virtual machine. I can rent power from Amazon. I can rent compute power from Google. I can put my control center in the cloud, and I don't care where it is. As long as I have a service, and as long as I have the correct level of security in place, not where it is. This is kind of telemetry. You see displayed from Cosmos, telemetry points, date, time, engineering units. You don't want to see it. That's what you want to see. The most fundamental display in Cosmos, this is more the what the telemetry grapher is showing you as the function of time, some of the values. We had two sensors on the GIMS prototype, one for light and one for temperature. That is the light sensor. And the other telemetry channel sensor graph, and these update automatically. There you see on the upper part the defined yellow and red limit on the telemetry points we had. This is becoming more and more friendly to see this kind of stuff. And that is a variation of file. Yeah, that's not terribly interesting. Now, companies normally don't get to see this, the video display from the Raspberry Pi itself. So the satellite video display is the screen capture from that, because we actually had a screen put into the video part. So you can see it's getting event messages, and basically the commands that we can send to it were temperature sensors, select the sensors, select those. So you can learn that. This is probably the thing that I'm the most proud of, because that it's a screenshot of my phone, and this is one of your data. And it's better and better apps we can get, graphs and stuff like that on the phone, too. For the moment, it's just a day. CAP is teaching student companies a project both in terms of operations and in terms of being engineering part of building it. Huge project. We'll build one at home. We can build one at our university, whatever, whatever. The huge part is it's kind of expensive to launch it. So that's really what's staying away of my friend over Capital is doing his own personal one. He went to the extent of building his own thermal vacuum chamber in his basement. And he's very poor on this stuff. And he wrote a couple books on it. But the trick is the launch. Okay, there's a lot to be learned by building one, but we'd like to, you know, launch it and see it work. So Capital actually won in open competition a launch slot in 2018 to launch their CubeSat. So that expense is taken care of. The project that we're launching is TrapSat, and it's looking at micro space debris, tiny little millimeter-sized particles that fly around, and that's going to be useful to have on space station for a while. We're going to do a quick launch. Any kind of a actual allows you a slot to put a payload in a sounding rocket, and they recover it at sea. They have a very good recovery. And then also we work collaboratively with the University of Maryland. We have a student balloon. We go up to about 100,000 feet near space. And now we know that this works because we have actual data on these microparticles. Are captured in a very strange material called aerogel, which I can't really explain too much about. Look it up on Wikipedia. It's really strange stuff. We use it as an incredible insulator, and we use it to capture these particles of space debris. The aerogel we use is white. You get a little particle hitting a dark spot. And in a lot of cases, you'll get a cascade, almost like a radiation pattern off of. We photo that and return the data. We're interested in where that piece of aerogel target got hit, size of the particle, and jump out every couple of minutes. That's the environment. So we're listening to work. What we're based on the summer project is pretty well decided to use Cosmos as a control center. I worked out really well. Control center function. Reading the PI and using its image processing pipeline, has a graphics processing unit on it with a free open source complete library. So anything you can do in Photoshop or GIMP or any of those is done on the entire architecture. So we're going to have more processing of data. Trying to say we got there even 10 years ago to get lynched, but we're onboard processing. The reason is we don't have a great now bandwidth. These are taking about 5 megs, and if you work on it, it takes to get the images a bit per second. So we realized that we don't need all the images. We approximation only need to send out a difference in the images. So then we know if there is a difference, then we need to send out a difference. We'd like to invite where it hit on the piece of material XY coordinate and what the change was, say, every minute or something like that. How much compression we can apply, what we really need to downlink versus what we can, but we have images in previous place. So we can do that on the bench. What you have to be careful of is when you run the graphics processing engine, you use a lot of power compared to normal operation. The trade of the energy cost of onboard processing. And it exists. Really, we can only transmit data down when we're overlaying, which is pretty easy to keep track of. We process the images when we're in sunlight. We'll have sort of a very complicated schedule when we can do things, but we're doing it now because we're still 3 years away. We're also going to be monitoring for radiation damage. We'll do active current monitoring and trending, because that's the key indicator that you're getting into a problem area. Functional self-checks. That could have been there. Yeah, I can't kind of find that as a homework from self-checks on the Arduino of the arm. So we have the heart signal and the ability, of course, to reset the system. I talked to you about having an Arduino architecture in the Pi. We know that the Arduino is more susceptible to radiation, so if you start seeing problems with that, and we'll start monitoring the Pi part of last year.
That's a canary.
Canary?
Yes.
Exactly. Well, we're still working on this. We want to do a secure commanding app for devices. We don't want our spacecraft to be hacked. Do a load test. We've only created it with one target spacecraft. machine, how particular architecture, how many targets can that server handle, obviously. And so it's per target number. We want to do CFS, and Alan's working on this a little bit, for the 32-bit Arduinos. Most Arduinos are 8-bit. There's a bunch of 32-bits involving, and we'll do the 32 and put it on board with this. To expand the use of Cosmos as a test environment when we're doing testing next door, there's two things that Cosmos enables to solve major problems that it's had. One is, Cosmos up and running, you've got your flat set laid out there, and you're doing your integration testing. All that's done, you have to define your telemetry points, your command points. When you get it done, you've got your control center software properly. You don't need to transition from a integration and test system to an operational system. Very, very close. And you're guaranteed at the time you test out your target hardware, you're testing out your test system. I see errors in terms of validation of control centers when there just wasn't any feed forward information from environment for both test and operation. It also has a command telemetry handbook generator. And I've heard transcription errors in the command telemetry handbook, I believe. So human intervention in that process, you define all your telemetry values and your cal curves and your limits, it produces TNT handbook for you. Of course, it's electronic, too. And before, make the telemetry limits checker smarter. I kind of hate to say expert system, but I'd like to see that limit checker be sort of a virtual team member, sort of a virtual system engineer that's more than this value exceeded this limit. I want it to get some other data together. Also, April's going to see if we can actually do host Cosmos or Android. I'm not sure it's a great use for that. It would be kind of neat to have a tablet, host it on a tablet and a laptop. And there's all sorts of other systematic stuff that we'd like to do. I suggest to you that if you're having a cube set or a small set project, or even a real project, Cosmos is a very interesting product. And it's a source. It's free. I don't know why Ball Aerospace did that. They didn't have the reasons for it, but it can't be a cost. And most parts of work that you pay for, this one will work. It is really nice. It's worth looking at. So, reference for this first reference is the radiation testing of the Arduino Raspberry Pi. That document was dated for Cosmos from a previous like, software thing. Aerospace is up on GitHub. You'd be able to see a better on the actual copy when you get the copy of the slide. Over Caltech, on the TrapSat project, and the kind of information for myself. Guillermo and Gabriel, if you want to talk to them, fine. Yeah, they're good. With all, it's hard to be here after putting all the work in.